gentlemen, today we have an honorable guest to our press conference, the 13th World Chess Champion, Garry Kasparov. Garry, thank you very much for coming here. Good afternoon. Good afternoon. Garry, my first question is, you know both players very well. You played a World Chess Championship match with one of them, although you didn't have the chance to play a match with the second. Although, of course, it was not your fault. And my first question is how you assessed both players before the beginning of the match, and how do you assess them now after almost half of the match is over? Well, I've already given my short, although not very diplomatic, estimation of the match before that, before it began. No one should get offended, it's just a fact, but it's for the first time over a long period of time that a World Chess Championship match with an official with the official champion and the official challenger does not have anything to do with fighting for the title of the strongest chess player on the planet. It's just the result of the accumulation of many problems that have accumulated over a long period of time in the system for playing the World Chess Championship matches.
Тем не менее, всегда матч на первенство мира характеризуется серьезной подготовкой.
Nevertheless, World Chess Championship matches are always characterized by very serious preparation, and this is why we are to expect some new ideas which will change our understanding of the game to some extent. If we compare this match with the previous matches which took place after I left chess, Akramnik Anand and Anand Topalov, in terms of its contest, this match is not worse than those. Now that the first five games of the match are over and they have been drawn, does it mean that the strengths of the opponents are equal, or maybe one of them has prepared better? I think it's quite obvious that both players are demonstrating certain cautiousness, although the reasons behind that cautiousness can be quite different. If I'm not mistaken, the last time when Gelfand won against Anand in the classical chess was in 1993. Yes, that's right. And it's quite obvious that playing against Anand in a World Chess Championship match, Gelfand is trying to be as reserved and cautious as possible. As for Anand, I think it's rather obvious that he has lost the interest to this game, which has always distinguished him. I don't remember when Anand won the tournament last time.
Как Анан играл в Лондоне, в Лондон Классик в декабре. Ну, в общем, ну как шахматист такого уровня, он по-другому как бы входит в игру. То есть я много играл с Анандом, я просто видел эту довольно.
I saw Anand play in London in December, and a chess player of this level could have a different attitude regarding entering the game. And I could see it personally once again in the corner. The similar picture was in November in Moscow. So I think this cautiousness will go on because Anand is afraid of losing a game, and Gelfand does not believe that after losing a game he will be able to win back. I think there will be another draw soon.
Ну, напрашивается параллели с несколькими матчами, но в первую очередь, конечно, можно вспомнить ваш матч с Вишей.
Parallels can be drawn, for example, with your match with Vishay, which began with 8 draws. So, do you have a belief that after a series of draws, someone should win, no matter, it doesn't matter who? Well, we had the first 8 games drawn, and then we had 5 resultative games out of 6 after that.
Ну, там, конечно, тоже были случаи нежелания.
Well, there were also cases when the opponents said we not want to continue the fight in those first eight draws. But I can remember game 6 and game 8 when where there were some very important theoretical duels. And in the games I played with Black, I remember the theory, the modern theory of the Scheveningen variation was prepared. Is there psychological pressure? Is there a desire to resolve this situation in some way? Well, along with the desire of both chess players, there is always the probability theory and the probability that one of the players makes a mistake and someone wins the game increases with each game. And secondly, we had a 20-game match with Anand, and this match is much shorter, so 8 draws out of 20 games is one story, and 6 draws in a 12-game match is a different story. Nonetheless, for Boris Gelfand, this is the first World Chess Championship match. What is the difference between the first match and all the others? My first match was in 1984, and there was a very tough system for selecting the challenger at the time. And I really had the impression of being about to fight the world chess champion, because there was a very strict system for selecting challengers within a 3-year cycle. This was a very lengthy match for me, so the opportunity to gain more experience was virtually unlimited. I think the public, the general public in any case, has a different opinion of these matches compared with what it had about 50 years ago.
Евгений Суров, Chess News. Очень жаль, что один вопрос, потому что у меня два немножко связанных вопроса.
Евгений Суров, Chess News. Yesterday, Anton Khorubov compared this match with your match you played in 1984, when the score was 4-0. Can you see any parallels in those two matches? There are two big differences. First, this is a 12-game match, and we had an unlimited match, and the score is 0-0.
Ну, мне кажется, вообще любое сравнение
Any comparison, I think, of an unlimited match with this match or a 24-game match with this match will be drawn a little bit too far. Because a 24-game match has the opening, the middle game, and the end game. Here we can have a very fast moving on from the opening to the end game.
Поэтому как бы, ну, мне немножко сложно комментировать, все-таки я обычно на длинный матч, самый короткий был Скрамник.
It's very difficult for me to comment on this, because my shortest match was with Скрамник, and it had 16 games. But I think it's better to compare this match with the most recent matches which took place recently.
Хотя я еще раз говорю, в общем, как бы вот три предыдущих матча.
But the three previous matches in 2006, 2008 and 2010, in terms of tension and pressure, were more interesting than this match.
Mr. Gelfand is an Israeli player, but he represents in some way the Russian or the Soviet tradition in chess. What do you expect, Mr. Kasparov, of the next generation of Russian chess players? Do you think they will be at the very first level in the next years?
Well, most of the leading chess players represent the Soviet chess school, more or less. And if you look at Anand's biography, he's becoming stronger, he's maturing, was under this very strong influence of the Soviet chess school. Because all the trainers of Anand in his first years of his career and all his team consisted almost completely of representatives of the Soviet chess school. As for the future of Russian chess, it's quite obvious that Russia has lost its dominating position in the chess world. Just look at the results of team tournaments, the results of the Olympic Games and major tournaments, as well as the results of young Russian chess players.
Совершенно очевидно, что вот в категории.
It's evident that among teenagers or young chess players, 20 plus years old, there is no extra plus chess player in Russia. When I'm talking about an extra plus chess player, I'm talking about chess player of the caliber of a world champion. The situation may change, of course, but so far any changes are not obvious. It's quite evident that the situation which has emerged over the past few years in Russia does not contribute to the preparing and development of intellectual disciplines.
Mr. Kasparov, this is Swami from India. We saw you play, some of us saw you play in 1995 against Anand. How has the game changed since 1995? And second part, how has the game changed in an era of computers and databases since the time you left chess and till now?
Если можно ответить на английском языке.
Our match in 1995 probably was a milestone for introducing computers into chess preparation. The famous game 10, which I won by introducing a big novelty in one of the popular theoretical lines, was the first experience where a primitive machine was used to check the calculations, and just to feel more comfortable about just doing a sacrifice. I don't see any significant change in the trend from 2005 to 2012. It's just going, you know, one way. Computer has been playing more and more aggressive role in the preparation of all top players. And moreover, I think computers affect the way the young players look at the position and consider their decisions. I think it's somehow some subconscious process because they used to look at the computer screen and they, you know, it's a machine. Unless you're a very, very strong player like Magnus Carlsen, it's very hard to resist machines' recommendations.
Chess5.com. I think at the moment there are two big camps. One camp, maybe representative is Mr. Danilov. He really believes in you have to change some aspects of chess to avoid a lot of draws like this. And then there's the other camp, maybe Mr. Shipov is one of them, which would say matches like this, that's the world championship, that's some kind of shaper, you shouldn't change it, that's just how it is. Where do you find yourself?
Since I've started playing the world championship matches, so we saw quite significant changes in the regulations, including time control, and the lengths of the event. I remember that when the idea was thrown to play 2 hours game instead of 2.5, that was like a revolution. And both Karpov and myself, we were very reluctant to even to consider that. And then we were moving towards the cancellation of the adjournment games. It was very natural because of the computers. But still, that was a very revolutionary shift from the sort of Botvinnik type world championship matches. I think that certain regulations that are being imposed in some events, like, you know, the Sofia rule, they also part of this natural process of keeping up with the tension of the game. Or in the tournaments, we may talk about three points for a win, which I think it's a bit excessive, because then the results might be totally unbalanced. But still, you know, the idea is gaining ground. And of course, there are most radical solutions to introduce some form of official chess, official random chess, to kill the openers. I wouldn't be surprised if eventually some kind of this reform will be introduced. From my perspective, again, it's the 960. It's the number is too excessive. I mean, most of these 95% of these positions are totally ridiculous from the human eye, from the eyes of the professional player. But there are still a number of positions that are quite playable, and I wouldn't mind if one position is selected for a tournament and announced in advance to give a little bit of space for preparation. But I wouldn't rush with such a dramatic change, because we know, again, looking at other events, that even the matches at the highest level can be very attractive. We just recently saw the match Kramnik-Aronian, 6 games, and it was a huge contribution to the game of chess, and it was also very exciting.
Ваше мнение на этот счет?
Gary, you have always been a very emotional player. Maybe somewhat on the subconscious level, you want to play this match at the moment. And some people even say that if you play the World Chess Championship match now, you would win. Now, what's your opinion on that account? Answer to the first question, no. I'm quite pleased with where I am now. As for the second question, I think there is a very big difference in understanding the situation between the amateurs and professionals. I think any professional understands that even for a chess player of my level, it's just impossible only to sit at the chessboard and play a top level match. And it's not only a question of preparation for the openings, but your mind just doesn't work anymore in terms of being ready for a fight in a 7-hour game. In blitz chess, with some preparation, I would probably be able to play fairly successfully, but in a serious classical match, it's just impossible. Besides, I'm very pleased with the historical score I have with both participants of the match, so I just don't want to spoil that statistics. And one nine games, and with Anand, the score is 15-3.
Saravanan from Telegraph, India. Mr. Kasparov, absolutely no disrespect meant to you, but you will understand, I hope, when I say that as an Indian, I was a little disappointed about your statement on Mr. Anand and his interest level towards chess. Two things. One is Mr. Anand has been forced to give up about a major part of his energy towards playing world championships for the last 4 or 5 years. And also, isn't it ironical that the day you visit, Mr. Anand has chosen to sacrifice a pawn with black pieces, thus describing ideas in chess, etc.?
I think as an Indian chess fan, you should be disappointed not with my statement, but with the state of Anand's chess. As for the big pressure on Vichy for playing world championship matches, I can remind you that Karpov and myself played many more matches in a much shorter time, a period of time, and it didn't prevent us from staying number one and number two. I'm a bit confused by the nature of the question, because I'm asked about my objective evaluation, and the fact is that someone who doesn't like it means no disrespect. As for the game today, actually number of pawns already equal, and this pawn sacrifice was not a result of a complicated middle game fight, but an open preparation.
Yeah. Ian Rogers, the Hindu. After your 2000
You're also working for India.
Outsource their jobs, yeah. After your 2000 match against Vladimir Kramnik, you said at some point you should have stopped trying to break down his opening preparation with the Berlin and just played chess. Do you think this is a tactic that Anand should be doing, since Gelfand's preparation seems so rock solid?
In 2000, I faced quite a revolutionary approach in Berlin, and while many people during the match thought it was just, you know, only Kasparov-tailored opening, we know that Kramnik actually has opened a new chapter of the modern theory. I think Berlin now is the most popular open. Not for the fans, but I'm talking about high-level tournaments, yes. Just name anybody from top 10 who never played Berlin. Can you name one? Maybe Rajabov. But again, you still have to think about it. And I guess Gelfand's preparation is sufficient, but I don't see anything revolutionary. So playing Grünfeld or Svechnikov, I mean, doesn't strike me as opening of the theory of the just pushing chess to the new horizons. Maybe there is something, you know, we could see if they play the main lines as Anand played with Topalov, but so far it's not striking me as something that will have a mark in the history of chess.
So you think Anand is on the right track though with his playing openings this way, or
just a moment, can I translate it?
You know, whether Anand is on the right track or not, we'll know at the end of the match.
Yeah.
In general, if you look at the history record, Vichy is a better player. And the fact is that Helge Jelfand couldn't win a single game for, you know, nearly 20 years. It's a fact no one can deny. Тем не менее, я бы все-таки, nevertheless, I wouldn't be making any predictions now. So it's too close and too tight.
You just said that.
Но стало хуже, чем в советское время, в каком-то плане.
Гораздо.
Что произошло? Объясните, пожалуйста.
The situation that Russia does not contribute to the development of intellectual discipline in Russia, so it's much worse than in the Soviet Union. But what has happened? Could you explain to us? Well, I was not planning to touch upon the ground which is not of any direct link to chess, so as not to disappoint the organizers of
но достойный ответ на ваш вопрос требует.
But a worthy answer to your question requires that I stop using only chess terms. It's quite obvious that the current regime in Russia is at least suspicious of any kind of intellectual activity.
И тот факт, что сегодня Россия столкнулась с самой большой волной.
And the fact that the current emigration from Russia has reached the largest level since 1917, and most of those emigres are young and energetic people, is the best indication of the prospects of young people in Russia.
Для управления трубой.
You don't need a lot of intellectual effort or intellectual ability to manage a pipe. They say that Alexander III had a famous saying, Russia has only two allies, the army and the navy. And Putin's Russia also has two allies, oil and gas. I'm from Gelenjik, that's probably one of the newest editions, and my question to Mr. Kasparov is what needs to be done to attract more sponsors to chess or the development of chess? First of all, sponsors are starting to emerge.
Сказал меценат. Мне так кажется. I would say it's more of a charitable activity rather than commercial sponsorship. Ну и этот матч, и матч, как я понимаю, Крамник, Аронян.
Just take this match or the match Kramnik-Aronyan. So there are currently some people volunteering to raise funds to attract interest to this game. But as you answered me a question which is not directly related to chess, the answer will be such as you will be interested.
Любое коммерческое спонсорство.
Any commercial sponsorship and advertising of the match directly depend on the prestige of the game and the global structures it represents.
And the reputation of the global structure which it represents. Совершенно очевидно, что...
It's quite obvious that chess just by definition cannot have a long-term commercial contract. The first thing a sponsor does, it just googles the needed people. If we just leave aside the extraterrestrial myths or nonsense which is spread by the FIDE president, his photographs with Gaddafi and Assad just kill and debut any ideas to support chess from multinational corporations. So without a full-fledged reform in the situation in chess management, there will be no radical changes. But we'll hope that the changes will arise. From myself, as you know, the organizers and sponsors of this pledge have made or invented an idea to hold this chess in the museum so that this could boost the chess economy in terms of its cooperation with art. What do you think about it, and is this a promising
approach?
If we look at this problem from a broader scale, I think this is perhaps the way of how to develop chess in the contemporary world.
The broader scale, including education. Education and culture as the two key elements of the future development of the modern chess. И мне кажется, что меняющая структура сейчас общественных приоритетов.
And I think that the changing structure of social priorities should help chess to find its place in culture and education, or among culture and education, and find more interest in the world.
Боюсь, комментировать уже будет нечего.
Сейчас, да.